So like Sarah said, my name is Samantha Westrich. I am one of the speech language pathologists, and I am housed in the Greensboro office. And today we will be talking about adapted toys. So the first thing that I wanna focus on is just play in general, especially when we're thinking of our individuals with more complex needs, typically physically, it's hard for them to have access to the typical things that we play with. And sometimes we think of play as only for our really young kids, but play is great across the ages, even for older individuals. So we wanna always make sure that we're thinking about how our individual is gonna access play, because play helps us develop a lot of different skills, and it also supports communication. Play provides tons of communication opportunities in a really natural, inspiring way. So it's a way to be fun and silly and kind of engage in a shared activity with these individuals. It's also a really great way to practice the use of switches that might be, especially for our early communicators, a skill that they need to develop to eventually access a communication device. So to use switch scanning, or something like that to communicate eventually. So again, we just wanna make sure that we're really looking at ways to give everybody the opportunity to access toys and access play. So what are adapted toys? Adapted toys are any toy or really any electronic that has been modified to be activated by an adaptive switch. And these are just some examples on the right. And really there are so many toys out there. And there are also things like fans or, Bluetooth music speakers. So the sky's really the limit when it comes to switch accessible toys. So one thing that I wanna touch on before demoing the toys is just how to choose the right adaptive switch. And a few weeks ago, I think it was like 3 weeks ago, our other SLP, Marissa Cohen, she did a presentation that focused on adaptive switches. And it's really thorough and kind of talks about all the different switches. But the reason I wanted to kind of touch on it really quickly today is that's sort of the first step. So we really wanna look at, especially for our more physically complex individuals, how are they going to be able to access these toys or environmental controls? So some things to consider, and this is taken from Marissa's presentation, are how are they able to move? What movements do they have control of? What actions are needed to activate the switch? So this is where a team approach is great. Maybe reaching out if they have an occupational therapist or a physical therapist that they're working with, or really talking to their caregiver if the person is not able to tell you, to see what motions do they have that they can control consistently and that don't require a lot of cognitive focus. So we want the movement to be consistent, and we really want it to be effortless, or as effortless as possible. And for some of our more physically complex, it could be that all movements are kind of effortful, but finding the least effortful. So again, just looking at the whole body, and I have some examples to the right. You can activate switches with your head, your thumb, your chin. You could do something like on the bottom right, which is a sip and puff, which, you could activate with your mouth. And then you could even, the man in the black sweater with what looks like a sticker on his forehead, he's using a twitch switch or a sensor switch. So if somebody only has like the slightest movement, like an eyebrow raise, something like that would work. There's switches to fit all sorts of needs, but sometimes it takes some work to figure out what switch is gonna be the best fit. So Tammy, who is our AT specialist in the Charlotte office, is going to demo some switch activated toys.
All right, let's see here. So this first one is gonna start the light, and I already have this one plugged in. So So as long as I hold the switch down, the light stays on and the volcano bubbles. To show you how to plug them in, the chicken here has the cord that has the 1/8 inch, and you just plug it in.
Hey, do you want to do the chicken dance?
And we listen. So that one starts and stops as I hit the switch. And this one, the plug-in is a little bit different because it's directly on. There's not a cord. This one has two switches. You notice the bow wow one, when I hit the switch while it's playing, it doesn't stop. And that is in the electronics of the toy, whether they're designed to play a certain number of seconds or if they play only and start over as soon as you hit the switch.
Thank you, Tammy. Those are so cute. let me pull these back up. Okay. And so as Tammy was showing us there, when this toy is switch activated, you can see that there's a little female jack kind of coming out of the toy that you can then plug an aux cord into, and that aux cord then attaches the switch. And like Tammy said, each toy has a different function. So some you might have to do a long press where you hold your hand on the switch, and as long as you're pushing down on the switch, the toy or the item is activated, and then when you release, it stops. Or like the little chicken toy that Tammy showed us, where you push it once, it plays, and then you can push it again once and it'll stop. So depending on how the toy functions, the switch will do different things. And some switch or some toys really can only be activated with one switch if they only have, you know, one on and off function. And then other toys that have more buttons and things that they do, they can be activated by multiple switches. So again, Marissa Cohen talked about this during her presentation, but sometimes switch adapted toys can get very costly. So depending on the toy, they run at least, you know, up to $30 or more, depending on the toy. And especially if you're kind of looking for toys for children, you know that children move through toys very quickly. And so one way around that that can be a little bit more cost effective is using a battery interrupter. And what the battery interrupter does is it slips into the battery pack. So you want something that has, you know, like maybe a zip pouch, and you open it up and it has that plastic battery pouch. And you can open that up and slip one of these battery interrupters into the plastic part. So you can see that image there. That's from Enabling Devices, and they have a more detailed article and some videos on exactly how to use a battery interrupter. But one thing that you want to keep in mind is that each type of battery has a different size little copper disc. So you do want to make sure that you're getting the correct battery interrupter depending on the type of battery that the toy has. And so you just slip that little copper disc into the battery pack. And then you can plug the switch into the female jack that's connected to the battery, and then it interrupts the communication so that now the switch is acting as the button press and not the button on the toy. And there is a video where an NCATP staff member shows us how to use a battery interrupter and switch adapt a toy helicopter. And that is linked here at the bottom right here. So again, just a cost-effective way. And then you can kind of move the battery interrupter from toy to toy, which adds some variety and some motivation. You know, kids don't want to play with the same toy over and over again. So that gives you an option to use a bunch of different toys. Another thing, and not everybody knows this, but you can use adaptive switches to access apps on a tablet, phone, or computer. And there is, again, a variety of Bluetooth adapted switches. And this may be a lot more motivating, especially if we're thinking about some older individuals that really still want to play. And apps give them the ability to play a lot of different games and do a lot of different things, you know, not just looking at recreation leisure type stuff, but also looking at some functional things. So again, it may be more motivating. It could be a little more cost effective, although these switches do run, they're in the hundreds, like $200 to $300. But if you think about, you know, a toy, that's $30 once you buy. But I'm awful at math, so maybe five, I don't even think that equals 300, but you know what I mean. They add up. So if you kind of just, you know that it's something that this person is gonna use, and it's also something that will grow with the individual. So even if they're younger and they're maybe just interacting with some more play-based apps, as they get older, they can then use the switch to activate other apps. And then again, it just provides access to a variety of activities, and it also could potentially provide access to communication or typing. So this next slide is just a video, and this is the AbleNet Bluetooth switch. And I have used it with the iPad. I have not used it with an Android-based tablet, but it works really well with the iPad. It did say on the website that it is able to work with Android and also with Windows and Mac computers. So it seems like it kind of covers all the different types of tablets and types of computers, but it would be a great thing to loan from one of the NCATP offices to try with whatever device you are thinking about using it with, just to make sure that they're compatible and it works in the way that you would want it to work. So this video is taken directly from AbleNet, and it's about 2 minutes long, and they just kind of introduce the switch and then also show you how to connect it to an iPad and what it looks like when you're using it with an iPad.
Hello, my name is Mike, and today I'm going to talk about the Bluetooth switch. The Bluetooth switch provides single or dual switch access to iDevices running iOS 7 or newer, Apple desktop or laptop computers running OS X 10.9 or newer, and all switch accessible apps or software on iOS, OS X, Windows, and Android. Bluetooth features a rechargeable battery and two external switch jacks, so a user can plug in any two switches they frequently use. Setting up your Bluetooth switch is easy. To begin, turn the Bluetooth device on. Then, turn on your Bluetooth connection on your iPad. Once it's on, it will search for Bluetooth devices in range. When the Bluetooth displays, tap on it so it begins pairing the Bluetooth switch with the iPad. Once the Bluetooth is paired with your iPad, you will need to set it up with switch control in order to perform scanning functions. To do this, you'll go into Settings, General, Accessibility, Switch Control, Switches. Then select Add New Switch and select External. Once prompted, activate a switch and name it. We recommend giving the switch an intuitive name like Orange Switch so you can identify it at a later time. Choose the function you'd like the switch to perform. To today we're choosing select item. We're also going to do the same for the other switch, except we're going to name it white switch and choose move to next item as the function. Now that the switch control features have been set up, I am able to navigate to the iPad using the Bluetooth switch.
This is Diane with more about the Bluetooth switch
from AbleNet or our entire line of products, visit us at www.ablenetinc.com.
And so you can see it's fairly easy to connect to an iPad. And one thing I really like about the Bluetooth is that it does have that external switch connection. So if somebody is using like a head switch or a sip and puff or, you know, a different type of switch, they can still use the Bluetooth to activate an iPad. I will say that not all apps are created to be switch adapted, and there's some workarounds on making some apps switch adapted. Some are created to be switch adapted or to be used with a switch. And so if you would like more information about that, feel free to reach out to me. I've done it before where we've sort of created, it's called a custom gesture, but there's a workaround to do that, and it's not very hard. And so that's just another idea. Something that I didn't put on the slides, but it kind of came to me as I was watching that video, is that the PlayStation and Xbox, the controllers, they have also adapted some of those to be able to be used by people with more complex physical needs. So that's another thing to kind of check out if you do have like a teenager who loves, you know, to game. That those products do exist. So for like video games and things like that. Okay, and that pretty much concludes switch adapted toys. Are there any questions?
Thank you, Sam. At this time, I'm not seeing any questions in the chat box. If you have a question, feel free to ask Sam or put it in the chat box. Gloria, are you seeing any questions on your end?
I am not right now.
All right.
Yeah, and one thing to add is that our offices, we all have a variety of switch adapted toys. So that's also a really great way to get access to toys. If maybe you're not ready to purchase or you know you're going to want a variety, reach out to your local NCATP office and see what they have to offer. We also all communicate between offices. So we all have a lot of different types of toys and things like that. So that's also a really good way to get access to adapted toys.
All right, thank you, Sam.
Thank you.
I just want to remind everybody of our upcoming AT Expo. So if you head to our NCATP website and you go there, we have a tab for our AT Exposition. This is a time where we have a lot of different vendors come and meet on Zoom, and they just kind of share what new technologies they have and new devices that they have coming up, and people really love it and have an opportunity to come and learn about these different assistive technologies. So if you're interested, I will put that link in the chat so you can go register for this event. I believe it is in October 7th from 9 to 5, and there is a chance to win prizes. So definitely join us for that. Oh, Jay has put it in the chat box. Thank you, Jay. I want to thank everybody for being on this call. You know, these calls are every Thursday from 11:30 to 12. So every week we have a different topic that we go over. Next week, we're going to be going over the Facebook Portal Plus, which is a really cool video chatting device that Facebook has come out with. So if you're interested in that or know anybody else who's interested, definitely let us or give them the information to log in and they can join us for that. I will also be putting the survey in the chat box. If you could take a moment to fill that out, that would be really great. That helps us to get feedback from you guys and just learn about what you guys want to watch on these sessions. Thank you, Sam, for sharing. Gloria, is there anything else you'd like to say before we end the meeting?
I don't have anything else. Thank you, Sam, for presenting for us today.
Of course, thank you guys.